Diabetes mellitus is a very common disorder, and I think practically everyone in India should be aware of what is diabetes. It's not only high sugar, but it also affects your proteins and fat metabolism. Broadly speaking, we have two types, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 diabetes is something which was described as a disease of young children, but we also see it in adults now. And type 2 diabetes was a disease which was described occurring after the age of 30, but we see it in children also. So age is not a primary differentiating factor between type 1 and type 2. However, the way they present, type 2 being an insidious disease, increasing slowly and then coming up with major symptoms, is different from type 1, which comes with a bang, and the child is generally very sick and lands up in a hospital as either gastroenteritis or losing a lot of weight. The differences also are in the etiology. Type 2 disease is something which happens because of a defect in insulin action, or we call insulin resistance, and it is generally associated with genetic history, family history, and obesity. Whereas type 1 diabetes is a disease which is not very well understood even today, but starts with destruction of the beta cells, so that slowly the number of beta cells goes on decreasing, and one fine day there is hardly any insulin being produced, and that's when the child ends up in the hospital. We are worried about diabetes not only because of sugar, as I mentioned, it affects the protein and fat metabolism, but what really scares us is the long-term complications of diabetes. And broadly speaking, diabetes affects the large vessels, like in other non-diabetic patients, so they're more prone to heart attacks, stroke, peripheral vascular disease, and specifically, it affects the small vessels or the arterioles in the body, and so they have specific complications described with diabetes, like retinopathy, the eye being involved, neuropathy, the nose being involved, nephropathy, the kidneys being involved. In addition, there are acute complications, specifically low sugar called hypoglycemia, and very high sugars which are described either as diabetic ketoacidosis or hyperosmolar non-ketotic coma. Hypoglycemia is a condition which, again, every diabetic should be aware of, because we are using medications to reduce the sugar, and sometimes for some reason either the medicine is too much or the patient has not taken enough calories or exercised too much and the sugar goes below normal, which is defined as hypoglycemia. The cutoff, we take it as 72 milligrams per deciliter, and we get really worried if it reaches 54 milligrams per deciliter. The patient may present as nervousness, palpitations, sudden onset sweating, increasing very hungry, or the friends, relatives or colleagues may feel that this patient is behaving abnormally. The first thing when you realize that there is hypoglycemia, the patient should be given something to eat. It could be anything which is in the vicinity, preferably pure sugar, carbohydrates, but it could be bread, biscuit, chocolate, sweet, ice cream, Coca-Cola. Anything and everything that we have told the patient not to take should be there for emergency. In rare situations where the patient may become very drowsy or may even become unconscious, then they need to be given parenteral glucose, or there is an injection called glucagon. If it's with the patient, then the relative or friend can inject them, and it gives good response within minutes. In the last 4 or 5 years, there have been a number of new drugs which have come into the market for treatment of diabetes, and the most important among them are DPP-4 inhibitors, SGLT2 inhibitors, and GLP-1 receptor analogs. I mean, these are technical names, but they've made a big change in the management of diabetes, and for the first time, the US FDA has given approval to two class of drugs for actually not only reducing complications, but even reducing mortality because of diabetes. And that's why it's really exciting to look ahead for treatment of diabetes. So a diabetic patient has the problem of taking a number of drugs every day, monitoring his sugars regularly, could be daily, could be weekly, or even once or twice a month. But the biggest problem is how to keep in touch with the doctor and what to do with all the information that they've collected. So there are a number of apps available which help you remain in touch with your doctor. It could be a daily feedback of the glucose reading, especially in patients who are on insulin 2-3 times a day. It could be even a weekly connection or a monthly connection. But these apps, not only in terms of monitoring, but in looking at the diet control and sort of exercise that they're doing, their activities which they're doing every day, has really helped diabetics in managing and getting them more comfortable.